Hello everyone, we are back on Oberon again, and I would like to bring my explanation for the Feigenbaum fractal gadget now to an end, because if we have finished this example, then you know everything to make any kind of visual gadget you want to make, because you swallowed all those principles that are essential for building visual gadgets and all this messaging stuff that's behind the hood. Okay, the last time I told you a lot of things, how the handler of the gadget is working, and what's lacking still is the explanation of the attribute handling and also the file handling, which is responsible for the persistence of the object, our fractal gadget named Feigenbaum. Okay, so let's start directly and dig into the gadget handler. You already know it. When we go down here, you see we have two else forks here. One fork is asking if which is the message that is passed to the handler is of type attribute message. Attribute message here is an abbreviation of the message type that is specified in attributes. It's defined in the start of our module, as you remember. If you don't remember, please watch the first video of the Feigenbaum gadget. And you can see that everything that is attribute message is passed over another procedure, which is called handle attribute, and it gets the frame, which is our Feigenbaum graph, and it also gets the message. So what does it do? So let's see what handle attribute is making. Okay, handle attribute starts here. Okay, you can see it gets the fractal as a frame, or more specified as a fractal, which is derived from the gadget frame, and it gets the message type. And what happens here is not very complicated. In fact, you know some of these basics from handling with the Columbus Object Inspector. You can see a lot of if statements here, if and else if. So first, the procedure is asking if you generally want to get informations about attributes and what information they contain, or if you want to change the attributes named its value in some way. So this first segment here is dealing with all those informations we want to read out from the attributes. So therefore, the first line is asking if the message ID is of type, is of the constant objects get. This is a constant, as I told you, specified and declared in the objects module, and it means objects get is something we put in the ID field if you want to read out attributes. And then we ask the name field of the message is of the string named GEN, which means generator. Or we ask if it's of the name backcall, which means background color. Or we ask if it's of the name plotcall. And if we switch quickly to the Columbus Object Inspector, it's already opened here, and it's linked to the gadget here. You can see that all those names appearing here, backcall, textcall, plotcall, gen, all these strings is something that has to be specified here. And it's obvious that every attribute name that Columbus finds has to be filled with information here, and everything that happens here is just that we put in the respective data fields here the information the Columbus needs to get when it reads out the value of an attribute. For example, when Columbus is asking for back color, which means the background color of the fractal, then first we put the another constant named objects int in the class field of the message type, which tells the recipient of the message that we put in information, and the information is of type integer. This is because the background color is an integer value. And then, it's obvious, we put our information in the I field here. M.I is the integer field. This is reserved for integer values. And we put in the information of our background color, which is named color back. This is something we specified as we extended the frame to our fractal type in the beginning of the module. And then this information is returned. Very important is always when you return a message that the result field is set to zero. Therefore, the system knows that the message was answered, or this is a response of, for the original message. If the value here is negative, then the system deals with this message as it isn't, as it wasn't answered yet. And this is the same procedure that is applied to every fork here. Doesn't matter if it's plot color or the text color or the axis color. All this stuff is handled in the same way. Put in the class field the type of information you want to send back, and then choose the right information field, put in your information, and set M result to zero. So let's see if we have something different here. Okay, you can see, for example, here, the attribute scales. As you remember, scales is the attribute that enables or disables the scalings and the rulers. And this is a Boolean value. So here you can see the class field is filled with a constant objects.bool, which means we have a Boolean value, and therefore the B field, the Boolean field of the message, is filled with f.scales, which is a respective Boolean formation that tells, that specifies if the rulers and dividers are displayed or not. So, and this is, that's all about the handling of attributes. But one very important information is still missing, and yes, this is this one here, and this is the GEN attribute field. This is always present in every gadget, and it asks for the generator procedure of the respective gadget. As I told you, when a gadget is rebuilded, for example, when you open the gadget and you previously stored it, then not the original gadget is loaded, it's rebuilded. And for the rebuilding, the system needs to know what the generator procedure is. That means which fractal, gadget, and which respective generator procedure has to be called. And for this is the reason why the answer to this question here, GEN, tell me your generator procedure, is a string, and the string has a content feigenbaum.new. This is because I told you in the last video, new is the procedure that is invoked when the gadget is rebuilded. So this is very important. If you do not provide this information, your gadget cannot be rebuilded, and therefore it cannot be loaded. Okay, in the second fork we're dealing with more or less the same things, but in a way that we want to change the contents of attributes. Therefore, we ask for the message ID content object set. Object set is also a constant that tells the system we want to change the contents of the, we want to change the value of an attribute. So it's the same thing as in the previous fog, the other way around. We're asking for the respective name, and then we put in the new, we get the information from the message data field. For example, a new background color is now provided in the I field of the message, and this this value is typecasted to short, which means it's a byte value, and then put into our color back data field of our fractal type. So it's just the other way around. There's nothing special in it. And then we still have some very important point to discuss as a last one. This is this one here. Because when you followed my videos very carefully, you may now have some very important question. The question is, how does Columbus know for which attributes it has to ask? Well, this is a very interesting question. When I link Columbus to this fractal gadget here, it shows me all those attributes that are specified as attributes and can be accessed from the outside. How does it know that? The explanation is very simple. There's a special attribute, let's say, asking that is possible, and this is object enum. Enum is an enumeration of all those attributes that the gadget is containing. And the rule is that we use the enum field and we put in all the strings, named all the names of all those attributes, and send it back one by the other until we send all those names of all those attributes that our gadget comprises. This is also very important. If you skip this very important part, then Columbus will not be able to display any attributes and you won't be able to change them. Okay, so that's all for attribute handling. Let's go back to our main handler, and we still have something left here. This is a file handler. I told you that the gadget system provides some very sophisticated way of dealing with persistence. That means when a gadget is stored, it has to provide a procedure that deals with a file message. A file message is a message that is sent to an object when it has to be stored or loaded. And the main part of this is always handled by the base class. You know that our base class is frame, and frame does everything when it receives a file message, what needs to be done to rebuild a frame or to reload a frame from the disk, or the other way around, to store it. And we just have to deal with those fractal specific things we made and with which we extended our frame class. So when we get this file message, then we pass it over to a special procedure named file properties. It's always a good idea to make a procedure set covering a specific area of dealing with messages. So it's always a good idea when you have some procedures, or one procedure dealing with file messages, the other with attribute messages, the other one with all this redraw stuff that makes the code more readable. So let's see what file properties does. File properties is located here. You see, it's a quite short procedure. It takes the fire message is a pointer. The variable here is m, and it's a bit similar to the message processing we already saw with the attribute handler. You see that we have two questions here that if is dealing with: is the message ID is object store or object load? So that means this bunch of code has to be executed when we want to store our fractal, and this bunch of code has to be executed when we want to reload it. And it's the same situation here like we already experienced this with the attribute messenger, attribute messaging handler, because what happens here is more or less the same, but only the other way around. So let's start with the object store. You can see that we are using a procedure or multiple procedures provided by the module files. Files provides procedures for writing, for example, real numbers or integer numbers, boolean numbers and strings. And we pass over the message field m.r. m.r is an information, let's say, of an open file that already was used to do all the storing regarding the frame base class, and now we are provided with this file handler to do our own stuff, which is just fractal specific. So at first we start by writing the data field x left and then x right, epsilon bottom. These are our data fields we specified by ourselves by extending the frame class to become our fractal class. And then we do the same with integer values here: background color, plot color, color of the x-axis, y-axis, and the text. And then with the boolean value, with the scales on or off, and then two strings with a labeling. And after this is done, this information is automatically stored in this big file where all the rest of the information regarding our frame components are stored. And if you load the stuff again, we have to do the same again in the same order. This is very important. You see, we start here with the write real fx left, and we start here with read real fx left. Then comes fx right, here comes fx right, f epsilon bottom, f epsilon y bottom, fy up, fy up. Don't screw this up. You have to obtain the same order, the same direction in both code segments here. Otherwise, you will get false informations and likely a system crash. So that's all. So you don't have to provide something like an own file where you store information, binary or an XML style or something like that. You are totally free from this charge, and you just can hook on this mechanism that Oberon is providing for you with these file messages. That's really something very convenient. I really love this. Okay, so I think we are through. Now we covered every aspect of this visual gadget, and I hope you learned enough that you are now capable of writing your own gadgets. And I would recommend that you start by programming something very, very simple. For example, make yourself a frame and just draw a circle on it, or some lines or rectangles, something like that. It's very easy. And then go up step by step until you can program something more sophisticated. That takes some time, because you have to get used to this procedures, and you have to get used to thinking over on. But believe me, it's worth every minute of your time you're investing. Okay. That's all for now. I'll see you again with my future Oberon projects. Thanks and bye.